In the previous video in this series, we discussed the neurological and psychological aspects of stuttering blocks. We explained how the larynx is neurologically programmed to perform effort closure as part of a Valsalva maneuver instead of phonating the vowel sounds of words or syllables, causing the speech mechanism to get stuck on the preceding sound or glottal stop, resulting in repetitions, prolongations, or forcing on initial vowel sounds. In this video, we will focus on some of the psychological factors involved in persistent developmental stuttering, including the role of beliefs, expectations, fears, and intentions. Stuttering blocks can be viewed as neurological motor programs that manifest the intention to exert effort in trying to say a word in response to fear and/or the anticipation of difficulty. The motor program for effort is influenced by our beliefs, expectations, that is, our anticipation of difficulty, and intentions. It may be further intensified by fear. For example, some typical unhelpful beliefs. I am a stutterer. Speech is difficult and requires effort. Certain words, sounds, and speaking situations are especially difficult. Stuttering is shameful and embarrassing. It will be terrible if I stutter. I must try hard not to stutter. Trying hard will help me force the words out. Negative beliefs lead to negative expectations, such as, based on my past experiences, I expect to stutter on certain words or in certain speaking situations. These expectations may be associated with varying degrees of fear. These beliefs, expectations, and fears give rise to intentions, most commonly to try hard to say certain words, to make a good impression by trying hard not to stutter, to show people how hard I am trying to please them. These intentions are associated with a motor program for effort. The brain neurologically prepares for the exertion of effort on the feared word by programming the larynx to perform effort closure as part of a Valsalva maneuver instead of phonating the vowel sound. Because the larynx isn't ready to phonate the vowel sound, the speech mechanism gets stuck on the preceding sound or glottal stop, repeating, prolonging, or forcing on it. Or the speaker hesitates or uses avoidance tactics while waiting for the larynx to be ready to phonate the vowel. This experience reinforces the speaker's negative beliefs, expectations, and behavior patterns, thereby perpetuating stuttering. To understand how stuttering blocks may be triggered by fear, we must look at the amygdalae, little almond-shaped structures in our limbic system, or emotional part of the brain. There is an amygdala in each hemisphere of the brain. The amygdalae are where fearful memories are stored. Their normal purpose is to alert us to danger. When we sense something that is similar to a memory of something dangerous, the amygdalae trigger a fear reaction, which prepares the body to respond to physical threats. The amygdalae are also neurologically involved in triggering Valsalva maneuvers. The fear response happens instantly and automatically, before we even have a chance to think about it. It is called the fight, flight, freeze response because it causes the body to freeze, to prepare for a fight, or to run to safety. When the amygdalae receive a stimulus that is similar to a fearful memory, they automatically sound an alarm, telling the hypothalamus to begin the fight, flight, freeze response. This causes stress hormones to flood your brain and body, preparing you for emergency action to deal with the perceived danger. The rational part of your brain shuts down, and you become focused solely on responding to the threat. Your muscles tense up, and your larynx may close to perform a Valsalva maneuver. This fear reaction is very similar to what often happens during stuttering blocks. When the person encounters words, sounds, or speaking situations in which he has stuttered in the past, the amygdalae trigger a fear reaction. Stress hormones flood his brain, causing him to forget anything he may have learned in speech therapy. His brain programs his larynx to perform effort closure as part of a Valsalva maneuver, instead of phonating the vowel sound of the feared word. This creates the impression of a brick wall. The person feels an overwhelming urge to build up air pressure and to force, or he may resort to his old struggle or avoidance behaviors. Blocking on the word reinforces the person's belief that speaking is difficult or that a particular word or sound is hard to say. This increases the sensitivity of his fear response even more. Therefore, blocking on one word may increase the likelihood that he will block on others. As in many animals, Valsalva maneuvers can make a person feel safer by puffing oneself up to look bigger and frighten off enemies, or stiffening the body to help one strike blows or to defend against attacks. Using the Valsalva mechanism to puff ourselves up may also help us feel safer. However, no one can talk while holding their breath. Nevertheless, we may have a hard time giving up this defensive habit, even though our reward would be easier and more enjoyable speech. Valsalva programming may also be reinforced through the use of effort to reduce anxiety. All the stutterers I have treated reported that, to some degree, using effort helped them feel less anxious. This was particularly true for those who had been criticized for stuttering as children. Using effort may have become a way to show how hard they were trying to please. Using effort was reinforced because of its short-term benefit in reducing anxiety, even though it perpetuated stuttering. Understanding this dynamic was crucial to reducing the effort used in speaking situations. The amygdala's sensitivity to fearful stimuli may vary depending on the situation. Their sensitivity may also be affected by the beliefs and expectations that we bring into the situation. We might visualize this as a speech alarm system, which can be set at various alert levels. In easy speaking situations, the amygdala's alarm system may be turned off, but see how the alert level might increase as negative thoughts and expectations start to accumulate. The first thought: I am a stutterer. Speech is difficult for me. The alarm system is activated to low alert. I always stutter in situations like this. Up goes the alarm level to moderate. Here's a big one. I must make a good impression. It will be terrible if I stutter. Now it's on high alert. Finally, I always stutter on P words, or whatever sound, and here comes one now. You can guess what happens now. As you can see, the speech alarm system is not at all helpful for speech. Nevertheless, we may have developed a strong attachment to it, perhaps because somehow it makes us feel safer. Now that we have a better understanding of the neurological, physiological, and psychological aspects of stuttering blocks, we are in a better position to deal with them. In the next video in this series, I will discuss the fundamentals of a new approach to stuttering therapy, which I call Valsalva Stuttering Therapy.